When we look at New Zealand's poverty crisis, we often look at it through an adult's perspective. But what does poverty look like through the eyes of a child? Well, in 2014, 168 Wellington children wore a body camera for 4 days, recording the world around them. Today, researchers are looking through that footage to understand the daily differences between children living in hardship and children living in privilege. For more, we're joined by researcher Louise Signal and Nikki Turner from the Child Poverty Action Group. Morena Korua, thanks for joining us. Louise, I'm going to start off with you talking about the research that you found. Our viewers can't see some of the images that were captured by these body cams, obviously for privacy reasons.
Is that better?
But I can. Yes, are you there, Louise?
I am, yes.
Yes, I was just saying that our viewers can't see these images for privacy reasons, but I can, and they're quite sobering. Could you describe for our viewers exactly what some of that footage captured and the differences that it captured as well?
Morena and Dara, thank you very much for having me. We found that the children had less healthy food, they had less books, play equipment. They didn't have balls to play in the backyard with. They had less after-school activities, less opportunities to participate in sport. They also lived in cold, damp, mouldy houses. There was no mould in any of the privileged children's homes that we saw. They also lived in overcrowded houses, which we understand the reasons for that in this current economic housing crisis. So we found what was really a complicated picture of poverty impoverishing children in every aspect of their lives.
How were the children chosen and what ages were they?
They were 12-year-olds, they were marvellous, and I would like to thank them incredibly for their wonderful work. They were researchers, and they wore these cameras for 4 days from morning to night here in the Wellington region, so a number of the cities here in rural areas here in the Wellington region.
Well, thank you for acknowledging the kids, because they've made an incredible contribution actually to the research we know now about child poverty. It's one thing to have multiple studies and research that observes these things, but it's another thing to see the world through their eyes. And when you were describing, most of what you were describing is what life looks like for children in hardship. So compared to the difference between what life looks like for children with privilege, I just wanted to ask you, were you perhaps surprised by some of the footage that was shown? Did it confirm, or was there anything in there that surprised you?
I think it would surprise a lot of adults to see this footage, to read our work, because I think many of us live in middle-class homes with middle-class privilege, which I enjoy myself, and have no idea about the extent of the poverty and the extent of which the multiple ways that it impacts and probably compounds on those children's lives to make it so much more difficult for them to live, you know, long, healthy, productive lives, to really, you know, fulfill their potential.
Nikki, I will come to you. Nikki is from the Child Action Poverty Group, and obviously you've seen a lot of this on the ground anyway, and you've got kids that you are working with. But what is it about what children see through their eyes that perhaps when adults look at poverty, their decisions and their understanding, the way they address poverty, may be different to what a child is experiencing?
Morena and Dara, I think it's really important to see it through the eyes of the child. This is a really hard message for us in New Zealand. We know poverty affects children, but what this shows very graphically is the effect across so many dimensions of our kids' lives. And this is what we see in the front line, is it affects their physical health, it affects their emotional health, it affects their ability to play, to join hobbies, it affects their nutrition, it affects their housing, it affects their ability to actually participate in society. We know this from all the international evidence, but I don't think many of us in New Zealand are aware of the depth of the problem and how much it can affect these children's lifelong trajectory. This makes a difference to all of us in New Zealand, because this lives with our children all their lives, the effect of poverty. There's a real urgency about this message, and a hard one for us as a community.
Nikki, I must acknowledge as well that since this study was done, the overall indicators measuring child poverty are trending downwards over the past 3 years. But I do note as well that when it comes to severe poverty, that indicator is showing that that hasn't changed for children living in severe poverty.
Yes, this is the big challenge. We acknowledge how much the government has done, particularly with some rises in benefits, a lot of effort going into healthy housing. But the depth of the problem for the children in the most severe poverty has not shifted much. You're talking, depending on your measure, more than 180,000 children. Their life trajectory is altered by living in poverty. It's a hard message for New Zealand at the moment. It's been a tough 2 years. Lots of people, middle New Zealand, are struggling. And yet, you know, as a country, for us, this matters. We need all of us to recognise there's an urgency, not just for this government, but across all of our party policy. This is one of the highest priorities for New Zealand, for us now and for our children into the future. This is a big number of children who are struggling to get occupational outcomes, to get educational outcomes, to get socially secure futures, good relationships, less mental health. It matters, and it matters hugely for all of us. We cannot underestimate the depth of the problem.
Nikki, while the overall statistics, which are trending downwards overall, may paint perhaps a positive light, the reality is that it's not transformative change, which is what this government had promised when they came into Parliament. So are we going hard enough, fast enough?
No, we're not going hard and fast enough, and we haven't for a long time. As I say, this is across all parties. If we as New Zealanders really understood the depth of the problem and the effect on our children long term, there would be an urgent response across every party to household incomes. These 180,000 more children living in the severest poverty, it's mattering right now to their lives, and it's going to matter throughout their livelihood. So, you know, time for us as a country to act. And as I said before, I appreciate how hard this is when everyone else is struggling. But this is a degree way further of struggling. And it is not right to allow our children to live in such significant hardship at this point.
Louise, I want to come back to you to go into a little bit more in depth into the research. Did you notice any differences between perhaps particular communities or ethnicities?
We did have equal numbers of Māori, Pacific and New Zealand European children, but we didn't find significant differences. We don't have a huge sample here, but when you aggregate it, you could see that indeed there were some trends where, as we know, Māori and Pacific kids are much more overrepresented, nearly twice as often in poverty as New Zealand European children. So indeed, we are speaking of them more than we are of New Zealand European children. And I think that's a travesty. It's a breach of the treaty, and it's also a breach of international law.
Louise, I'm looking through these sobering images again as well. When you talk about the differences, I mean, what I'm seeing here, you know, you've got a bowl of fruit, bananas, apples, oranges sitting on the kitchen table, and then you go to a household with high socioeconomic deprivation and there's hardly anything in the fridge, and there is no bowl of fruit there. And in another household with children in privilege, there are bookshelves just filled with books. There are toy equipments, play equipments that just we already know and understand would just help further the development, mental and physical development and emotional and well-being. And then you go to a household with low socioeconomic and there's just no toys, empty backyard and no toys, maybe lucky if you've got a ball in there, and nothing in the house, no books or anything. I mean, they may be subtle differences to somebody going into a house perhaps, but they make a world of difference for children, don't they? And they're certainly a determinant for health in the long term. What would you say to the government today in terms of the perhaps urgency we need to address this now?
I agree with Nikki, the urgency is there, but I have been very impressed with the work of the current government. I don't think we've ever recovered from the mother of all budgets that the national government put into place in 1991, which slashed benefits. We've never recovered back to that level pre-1991. And we don't compare ourselves well with other countries. Countries like Sweden, where they focus on children as their sort of number one policy priority because they want to build a flourishing society. They want to do what Dame Finner challenged us to do, Dame Finner Cooper, to take care of the children, because as they grow, so does our nation.
Louise Signal, thank you very much for your time. Researcher from University of Otago, and Nikki Turner as well. Thank you for your time and the work that you are doing on the ground. Nikki Turner from Child Poverty Action Group.